Howdy, fellas! It's time for another radio. The last one I did was about a year back, year and a half maybe. So my apologies to all those of you that subscribed on the Nordmender Tannhäuser, I think it was, and never saw another radio get done. It's time for that to change. This year is a Philips Capella. It's from a neighbor, and the paint on it is an absolutely immaculate shape, so we're not going to do anything about that. It hasn't run in quite a while, you know, it's the usual sentinel basement, stuff like that, and the keyboard is a little bit sticky, so sometimes when you switch it off, then it doesn't actually switch off. And of course we're going to do the usual service overhaul of replacing all the capacitors. From what I've been told, it's been working, so that's, you know, a plus. It's not going to be too difficult. Still, I want to give it a close overall look, see if anything is obviously wrong. Then we're going to plug it in with the light bulb in series, see how it does. And if everything's fine, then I see no reason why we shouldn't just replace the cups and call it a day. So, let's get right into it. So, looking at it the first time, nothing too alarming here. Whole damn lot of tubes. And here's the FM part, there's the ferrite antenna, bunch of speakers, 5 in total, tone regulator, and the amplifier has a rectifier tube, so there's no selenium rectifier to have gone bad. We'll see about the condition of the magic eye, but all in all, it's not even too dusty in here, so, you know, I'm positive we can get all this off with a brush and vacuum cleaner. So let's look underneath. So the schematic laid in here, and well, it's a little dirty, but other than that, it's really clean underneath here. That's very good news. Here's a tar capacitor, some right over here, a couple of electrolytics. The main electrolytic is right over here. Yeah, nothing really obviously wrong with this. No burnt resistors, no melted cable connections. No, I've seen worse looking capacitors too. These don't have any holes in them, they're not cracked. So right now I see no reason not to power it up. Okay, antenna's plugged in. The radio is in series with a 60 watt light bulb. This is quite a large behemoth, so it might take a while for it to come to life, if that's going to suffice at all. But for now I'm going to switch it on, pay close attention to what that's doing, and you know, if we just get hissing or no real sound out of it, then we might actually plug it into full 230 volts, but before that I want to make sure there's no dead short circuit in here or something obviously wrong. So here we go, fingers crossed. Okay, very bright light at the beginning. That's standard when all the tubes have to warm up. It's slowly dimming down. The camera might not be showing that. Okay, this is consuming heavy amounts of power. The scale lightings are just about on, but there are so many tubes in here. You know, this is going to draw some heavy, heavy current. I can hear a slight hum out of the speakers. So, yeah, if you ask me, that's too much restriction. I could, however, hang on just a minute. But don't ask me why I'm in possession of a 200 watt light bulb. So, we can screw that into here, it should be, you know, a decent amount of restriction. Yeah, look, now that's barely glowing, actually. And now it's a little lighter there, you can see, probably because the tubes are starting to conduct. That tells me the rectifier is working, we've got high voltage. And Now you can hear. Noise. Hey! Look, I fixed it! Oh. Call me the radio magician. Okay. Okay, so the radio overall is actually working very nice. So, before we get into any sort of copyright trouble or trouble with the radio, I'm going to switch it off and we'll dig into the insides of this thing. First off, cleaning. Now, before we start digging underneath the radio, I'm going to start off with all the capacitors on top here. First of all, let's look over here. I said before that this fella here is the rectifier tube. And looking at the socket, you can see two capacitors here. Do not replace these. And do not leave them in either. Just snip them out. I'll show you why in a second. These are pretty dangerous, and if you absolutely want to leave them in or replace them, then you have to put safety type capacitors in there. They're, I think, Y2 coded, and when they fail, they won't short. And you can see this one already looks borderline done for, so you know, might as well leave them out. Back in the day, these were, well, cleaning the input voltage from any RF. I really haven't had any problems without those either. So, you know, just leave them out. Don't bother with it. Because when they fail, and they should short out, then you're in big trouble. We're talking about these two fellas right here. They're going from the secondary side of the transformer into the tube, of course, and then right to ground. So if they short out, then you're grounding the secondary winding of the transformer out. And oh boy, are you in trouble if that happens, because then you can throw this entire thing away immediately. Next up are these two guys down in here. They're electrolytic capacitors, which you know by looking at them. I don't know, after some time you just get the hang of it. But the problem is I can't read the values on them because they have this piece of paper wrapped around them. And before I dig into it, I'm going to try and find them in the schematic. So what I can see is that they're both grounded out. You can see the middle post goes over here. And then they both have a resistor across them. And when I try and measure that resistor, that tells me 228 ohms. So, we're now going to walk over to the schematic and see if we can find two electrolytic capacitors close to each other with a 280 ohm resistor across. Looking at the schematic, the only thing that made sense that I found were these two here. 250 microfarad, two ground, and a resistor across. Now these are 150 ohm, and I'm not quite firm with the color coding on the resistor, so I can't tell if those that are on there are supposed to be 150 and just grown in value, but all the other electrolytics here either don't have resistor across of them, or their values make absolutely no sense, like 1.2K, for example. And these two were also in proximity to the EL86 tubes. So it's making sense. Now to confirm that, I'm going to have a look if the resistor and the capacitor are actually plugged onto the cathode of one of the EL86s each. To find that out, we need to know how the socket configuration is, and we find that also on the schematic here. Here's EL86 right there, and now we are looking for K for cathode. There it is, and it's 1, 2, 3 from the right. We're always looking from underneath into the tube. So we're now going to go to pin 3 and see if those capacitors are actually hooked up to that.
Simply a question of applied dynamics and mechanics.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I don't get it.
So, the radio is on its side, and to find the connector, I'm going to go onto this prong here with the multimeter, and then flip over, and by, you know, seeing which wire it is that comes out of the capacitor, I traced it to over here. That is actually pin 1, 2, 3 of one of the EL86s. So we're going to confirm that with the multimeter. If it shows 0, then we can be sure that that capacitor is in fact 250 microfarads. And bingo! So that is, or those two are safe to say, 250 microfarads. Voltage-wise, there is no need to worry. Take a look here, it says 7 volts. So a 16-volt capacitor should do just fine in this case. See, I like to start off with electrolytics because my arsenal with these isn't as big as with regular capacitors, and therefore I can see what kind of electrolytics are in this thing and then order ones that I need and continue on working on the regular capacitors while they're arriving. Now, how is the polarity on this one? It's most likely negative against the frame, but you never know, especially with these hi-fi radios. They do some weird stuff occasionally. Okay, it's negative against the chassis, nothing out of the ordinary here. Okay, so this structure is pretty solid, but I went ahead and did some shorting out prevention here in the form of tape, and as long as you don't show this to an electrician, I think I should be fine. Now, these four guys down here are electrolytics as well, and you can either determine their value by deduction, because they're all the same, and the only ones on the schematic that are four times the same are 8 microfarads, so these will be 8. Or you can just simply, you know, snip these open and take a peek below their covers and see what it says on there. And it does indeed say 8 microfarad. I don't have any of these in stock right now, so I'm going to skip these for the moment. And while the order is out, I'm going to bother with the last electrolytic that's down in there. Maybe able to see it, maybe not, the silvery thing. That is a 25 microfarad, and I have the replacement waiting here. And after that, we're going to deal with all these tar and paper capacitors. And of course, these pieces here as well. Now, the problem here that I'll inevitably be facing is lead length. I mean, this is quite the whopper, but this one, probably desoldered from a PCB, has only these short stubbies here. However, when you take a close look, I hope this is visible. It is, of course, not. So let me bend that out of the way. Can you see it now? Yeah. One end, and that's the negative end, is tied to ground. And ground is ground anywhere in the radio. So you could tie it to the chassis here, you could tie it to the chassis right here. And what I'm going to do, bend that back. Don't do that too often, the wires will snap eventually. I'm going to use the plus point as the plus point, of course. And then I'm going to go just below it where there is a ground hook on the socket for the tube. Now you didn't see any of that, you just have to trust me. There's the first culprit.
Are you ready for a little magic trick? Okay, here you can see, no capacitor in there, right? Now it's all hair, and now there is a capacitor! Boom!
Alright, there's our first capacitor underneath the radio. They are not all that hard. I just like to do the hardest part first and have the simple stuff left over. Next one, probably one of those way down in there. That's one more capacitor in place. I've decided those two way in the back, I'm going to do either from the top, or if I can't reach it, then I'm going to have to take the whole chassis out of the housing. We'll see about that. Now we're going to continue with those over here. And you may be asking yourself, why the hell does he do all this effort to unsolder from the old lugs and then solder onto there? There is a J-hook method, and it seems much more convenient. Just snip the old capacitor out and bend the end of the lead over, solder the new one onto that end. Well, yes, for once it doesn't look as tidy, and also I have noticed that the solder won't stick to a J-hook that well. For example, if we took any lead, this one for example, you can see that it's not nice and shiny, it's dull. And that's because it's corroded over 60, 70 years. And therefore, the solder won't really bite into it. So you may be able to lay a nice drop on top of it, but it's not going to fuse together with the new capacitor. I've found numerous occasions where I plugged in a radio, J-hooked together, everything looked fine, and the solder joints were actually crap. So that's why I'm going through unsoldering from each post where there is solder on there, which will grab onto fresh solder just as nice, and do what first seems to be the more laborious way, but in the long run, I think it's the neater way to do it. Basically, all you have to do is heat up the lug and then pull hard on the end that you want to desolder, because the lugs are going to take it. And if the lug is bent over, like this one here right at my fingertip, then it's going to straighten out just by pulling on it. It's not that hard, and in the long run, it's just the better variation. Montage time!
Thank you.
Right, so that's the underside of this thing done. Except for those two right in the corner. And I'm still contemplating whether to do it while the thing is inside the housing or to take it off. I'll decide later. Well, later means now, because that's what we're going to tackle next. So the capacitors we want to work on are right beneath here, and that's way back in the radio. So yeah, there is no alternative. This thing will have to come out, and thankfully you can just unplug this. And as for the speaker wires, they've left us a nice loop around one of the speakers, which hopefully gives us enough cable length to just have it part way out and work on the thing. On that note, I was also able to free up the sticky keyboard, and all it took was a drop of oil onto the tuning shaft you see here. That allowed the pulleys to slide freely again, and now there is no stickativity going on anymore. Well, another day, another dollar. The capacitors are here. So now we can take all these buggers here out. Let's not waste any time, get right to it. Okay, this was quite the fight. You can see I've now got these rather loosely tucked in here. Did it look neater beforehand? Yes, it did. Will this work just as well? Absolutely. Next up are these capacitors in a can. This is 2 × 8, and this is 3 × 50 microfarad. The customer doesn't care about refilling these or retaining original optics, so here's what I'm thinking. Look at all this free space underneath here. This is the one can, and this is the second can, and we have tons of space here to put capacitors and even holes in the base to strap them down to, so I'm not even sure if I'm going to actually remove the original ones or just leave them as they are, disconnect them, and then, you know, move the place that they're soldered to somewhere else. So, those are the electrolytics done. Did it look tidier before? Yes, it did. Will these fail due to age? No, they won't. So, I'm preferring this over what it was like before. I did a couple of small changes, but nothing that would change the circuitry here. And that's basically the whole thing done. Now, one last thing I'm going to check is this resistor right down in here. Can see it looks a bit like it's had it, and I'm just going to make sure it still has its value. If not, I'm going to replace it, and after that I'm calling this done and ready to be powered up again. Okay, we're expecting 275 ohms. Spot on. All right, you may stay. Let's put the lid on this thing, fire it up. Okay, drum roll please. We'll be starting with the big restriction first, of course. And if everything appears fine, then we'll move to the larger bulb. Here we go. Transformer doesn't hum, so it's not overloaded. And the bulb is starting to go dim. So I'm confident we can jack it up a notch. Okay, that's no brighter than it was before. And there it is.
Jetzt muss man mal dazu. 10 Euro pro Monat sind keine. Tatsächlich, wenn der Test geknirscht hat, dann ist das auch ein politisches, riesiges Problem, ein politisch riesiges Problem für Yvonne Gebauer.
Sûrement, c'est une erreur en mettant pas le paquet sur.
This is French a long way.
Fatality and non-essential shops can open.
And this is BBC.
With all that in mind, we thought we'd take a look at what we now do.
This is so impressive. We're in the basement right here. Most radios don't pick up anything. There is nothing down here. And this is... Okay. Back to life. I'm going to tell the customer if he wants to how to install a new magic eye. That is pretty dumb. Other than that, I mean, this thing has a sound quality that's absolutely impressive. So we're going to have it test run for at least a couple of hours just to make sure nothing is going wrong in here. And then it's back to the owner. And most of the time, that's the case with old radios like this, is, you know, remove all the capacitors, clean it up a little bit, a bit of oil here and there, and it's done. That's why I don't show radios that often, because this is, you know, the standard schematic on how to work one of these, and it doesn't change over the radios, and when there is a problem, then I'm starting to guess myself as well, and that wouldn't make for a coherent video, because it's mostly trial and error at that point. However, here's one more back alive. Well, it was alive beforehand, but safe for, you know, enduring operation. And there is some more radio content coming up. Somewhere in the near future will be FM retrofitting another radio. But for this video, that's it. Thank you for staying this long. And see you all next time. Bye.
Am besten weichen Sie parallel über die parallel verlaufende A3 aus. So muss es heißen. WDR 4. Mein Radio.
Na, Einrichtungsboom. Insgesamt die Lage jetzt gesprochen.
Ja, nach meiner Wahrnehmung noch nichts. Dass wir auf die Kleidung gucken, natürlich.